Father God, we thank you that it is well with our souls, Lord. It is well because you have come, you have rescued us, you have saved us. Now we live and we exist for your glory. We live to lift your name up, and I pray for the service, Lord, that it would be glorifying to you, that we would be making disciples, that we would hear your word, and that we would respond to your word, and that we would worship you, and that we would have a great time of fellowship with one another. And that's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again, to live hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from dead, to obtain the inheritance which is imperishable, undefiled, and will not be fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are protected by the power of God through faith, for the salvation ready to be revealed at the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, even though now, for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials, so that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold, which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not see him now, but believe in him, you greatly rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, obtaining as an outcome of your faith the salvation of your souls.
Thank you. Hello, guys. Yeah, thank you, just a few of you. Hello, church. Oh, sorry, it was my fault. It's not just guys, church. Good to see you tonight, and it's a big pleasure for me to be with you tonight. My health is kind of on the edge between sickness and to be healthy. So some of you I asked to pray, and thank you for your prayers and support, because it's kind of hard to preach when you're sick, especially when it's about your voice, like but still, as I said, it's great, like big joy for me to be with you here tonight and talk about stuff God put in my heart. And, you know, looking back on this whole year, how it went, everything happened during this year, like with job, with family, with some relationships or some stuff in my life. I learned some lessons, and I'm so thankful to God for this stuff and for these things He done in my life, because He taught me something important, and this is what I want to share with you tonight. But first of all, I want to ask you a question. So the topic is Jesus reigns forever. Did you ever thought about what would you do if you have power? I don't know, supernatural power. I don't know your relationship with Marvel movies or something like this. I don't know. Okay, yeah, it's Ephraim. Right. I don't know. Do you like to dream or think about stuff like this? What happened if I have power, like just enough power to rule over the nations? Like to be a president, changes you will make in your country, or something like this. Have you ever have thoughts like this? Some of you, yeah. So I like to dream sometimes. Sometimes it's just stupid dreams, not dreams, just like think about. But when I read this passage about Jesus reigned forever, and we will read about, I came with this question. So, okay, how I can build my sermon? This is the fact we believe in. Jesus reigns forever. What does it mean? How it can help me in my life? How it can like reflect on my life? How it can change or support me in my life during all these situations and all these problems? Or I don't know what you have or what you go through. How this idea of everlasting King can help me in my life? Because the history, and I'm kind of jealous with Elijah, with his presence of this map. I like maps, and I remember when I was a student in the middle school, my favorite class was history, and there was old maps, and teacher was about to throw them in the garbage, and I took them and keep it in my house, and they was like huge, and like it covered like maybe 50% of my bedroom, and I like to uncover them, like open them, and go through the old cities, all these situations, like I know they happened, and I kind of jealous with this present, like nice, I don't know who did it, but great, like respect. And during the history, all these borders and all this stuff, history knows great leaders. And when I say great, it doesn't mean they was like great awesome. They had a lot of like great power. Not too long ago, there was Stalin, and he was a leader of Soviet Union. And during his time, tens of millions of people was killed. I don't know how you like, how friendly you are with the history, but talking about Hitler, same thing. Talking about, I don't know, Napoleon or other guys like Caesar, they like killed a lot of people to build peace in their countries, or they dream actually about whole world. So how this idea about Jesus, the King who reigns forever, can help me in my life? And I read this passage. I hope we already know this memorize it. It's Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. It's like fifth Sunday already in the row. We read this passage again and again. And I don't know if you memorize it or not. Hope you will do it, if not yet. But reading this passage again and again, I just trying to find out the central idea. What is the idea of the prophet he wants to bring to people? And if you will look at this passage, like context of the passage, Israel was in the war with other country. There is no peace, there is war, there is death, there is blood, there is destruction, there is disappointments, there is a lot of sorrow. And I want to read with you tonight again this verse, verse 6, but I want to start with verse 5 and finish with the verse 7. So Isaiah chapter 9, 5, 6, and 7, I want to read this with you. For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle, tumult, I try to memorize it because this is a new word for me. And every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increases of his government and of peace there will be no end. So Israel in the war, there is blood and death, as I said, and there's prophet came and said, don't be troubled. There will be peace. There is end for this war. And there is sign for you. The child is born. And it's not just a regular child, it's a special child. He's a ruler of the nations and government on his shoulders, and his name is Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And here is the thing: of the increase of his government of peace, there will be no end. He will reign forever. And it's not just Jesus, guy with a name Jesus. His name is Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And I read this again and again, these names, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, again and again. And I came with this idea, like one word which summarizes all of them. And this word for me is responsibility. When we talk about Jesus Christ, it's not another Stalin or other guy with a lot of power in his hand, and he has power over your life. He can kill you. He can put you in the prison or something like this. It's not guy with a huge ego, and because he has power, he can do whatever he wants to do. We talk about Jesus, who is Wonderful Counselor. And you know, when you're a counselor, you want to be sure that the advice you give to people, it's good advice, right? And not every person can have this name, Wonderful Counselor. Because you have this name because your advices really are wonderful. It's about your wisdom. And when you give a counsel, like advice to somebody, you're responsible for this advice. You are responsible for this advice, Mighty God. And you know, when you have a power, you are responsible for this power, how to use this power. What do you do with this power? So it's again about responsibility. When you have this name, Everlasting Father, and you hold everything in your hand, like time and universe, everything under your control, you're responsible of the for all process in this time and space. When we talk about Prince of Peace, you're responsible to bring this peace to people or wherever you are. So when I read this verse, I don't know about you, maybe it's just my revelation, but when I read all these names, I came with this idea of responsibility. This verse is about responsibility. And prophet said, right now you're during the war, but there is child was born, child who is responsible to bring you peace, and he's responsible to keep this peace forever, and there is no end for this peace, because he promised you that there will be peace. And I want to talk with this word for a while. I want to build my sermon around this word, and then we will talk about again about everlasting kingdom. Or what does it mean, Jesus? How I can use this idea of Jesus who reigns forever? This word peace, we used to say, like, peace be with you. And we mean there is no war, or just have good relationship with somebody. But when we go into the Bible and look at this word in the Hebrew, by the way, it sounds like shalom in Hebrew. Probably a lot of you know this, but it has bigger or deeper meaning than just peace. This word shalom means complete, whole, perfect, to be in harmony. And I want to show you a few verses in the Bible to prove this. For example, when you read about the stone without flaw for the altars, Bible use word shalom. So please open with me book of Joshua, chapter 8, verse 30 and 31. At that time, Joshua built an altar to the Lord, the God of Israel, on Mount Ebal, just as Moses, the servant of the Lord, had commanded the people of Israel. As it is written in the book of the law of Moses, an altar of uncut stones, upon which no man has wielded an iron tool. An altar of uncut stone. And this word uncut, in Hebrew, there is word shalom. You need to take for altar, you need to take piece, like stones, shalom stones, which means whole, unbroken piece of rock, to build this altar. So it's not just about peace. There's nothing about peace when we read about stones, right? An uncut stone, and the author used this here the word shalom. This word also means security, because everything is in harmony. So book of Job, chapter 5, verse 22, 23, and 24. At destruction and famine you shall laugh, and shall not fear the beasts of the earth. For you shall be in a league with the stones of the field, and the beasts of the field shall be at peace with you. You shall know that your tent is at peace or secured, and you shall inspect your fold and miss nothing. This word peace, you have peace, you can be sure that your tent, your house, in peace, your house is secured. Why? Because you have union, you in the same league with the beasts of the field. So everything is in harmony, that's why you're secured. And here is used the word shalom. Do you remember the king of David, King David? When he was a young boy, like right before he became a king, there was war. Again, there was war between Philistines and the Israelites. And his older brothers, they was on the war. On this war, and father gave some cheese and some other food to David and said, send him and said, go give this food to your brothers and ask about their shalom. So there on the war, there is blood and death every day. And father sent David and said, ask about their shalom. And he is not talking about no war, no death. He talks about their condition, about their like souls, their mindset. So when we talk about peace, when we talk about shalom, it's not just no conflicts, to be in good relationship with all people, or just be okay with everybody around you, be okay with you. It's more than this. It's harmony. It's to be complete, to be perfect in whole your nature. So I want to read this. In other words, shalom is a complex concept of that includes all different areas of your life, well-being, health, relationships, situations, and when one of them is broken, the world collapses. Life is no longer whole and needs to be restored. So, again, when we talk about peace, it's not just no war. It's a complex of whole your life, your mindset, your health, your relationship, your soul, everything together in harmony is a peace. And when it's something one, just something one is broken, the whole world collapses and you need to be restored. When this word shalom in the Bible used as a verb, it's even more interesting. First Kings chapter 9, verse 25, I want to read with you. Three times a year, Solomon used to offer up burnt offerings and peace offering in the altar that he built to the Lord, making offerings with it before the Lord. So he finished the house. And this word finished, in Hebrew, there's word shalom. He complete the house. He put the last brick in the wall, into the wall, and it become whole, complete. Finished. So when we use this word peace, it means to make. This word shalom in the as a verb, it means to make complete, to finish up, to build up and finish your construction. One more example, it's book of Exodus chapter 22 verse 5. If a man causes a field or vineyard of the to be grazed over or lets his beast loose and it feeds in another's man's field, he shall make restitution from the best in his own fields and in his own vineyard. And this word restitution in Hebrew is shalom. When your beast destroyed your neighbor's field or vineyard, you need to pay back to restore to shalom what was broken, to restore what was broken, to pay off your debts. This is the meaning of word shalom, to restore, to pay back, make restitution so there is no loss for your neighbor. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 7, when a man's ways please the Lord, he makes even his enemies to be at peace with him. So here is the idea of restoration, the relationship. The enemy is a guy, not just a random guy, it's like, I didn't know him, but he is my enemy. Why? Well, I didn't know. No, you can be the enemy with somebody you know, and very often you know this person good enough to be his enemy or to be enemy to him or to have him as your enemy. It means you sometime you like once a while you have this relationship but then something was broken. And this word to be at peace with him means to restore relationship which was broken sometime. So when we talk about peace, it's not just no war. It's to be whole, to be complete, to be in harmony with you and the world around you. It means to restore what is broken. And with this understanding of this word, with this deep meaning of this word, I want to read this verse again. I mean three verses again. For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government on and of peace there will be no end. And this is God's promise to us. There will be day when child will be born. And it's not just about forgiveness of our sins. It's not just to pay off my debt. The idea of Jesus Christ to come on the earth, that like one of the main ideas of Jesus Christ on this earth was to bring peace to us. And when we talk about this peace, as I said before, it's nothing about not being in conflict with somebody. I mean, not just this. But it means to have peace in conflicts, in sickness, in losses, in death, in any area of your life, in any problem of your life. Jesus came to bring this peace in all your life, in all situations of your life. Jesus came to make you whole, to make you complete, to restore what was broken. Because when we talk about this peace that reigns in the Trinity, when we talk about Father God, Father Son, Father Holy Spirit, we can start with the Holy Spirit, Father Holy Spirit, Father, God the Holy Spirit, God the Father, and God the Son, they have peace. It's not just they know have conflicts. It means they live in harmony. They support each other. They understand each other. They build each other, if it's right to say about God. They do everything together. They have this whole shalom in their relationship. This is the peace. This is the shalom. What was brought by God to the earth and given to creation in the paradise. And Adam and Eve, they had this shalom between them and God. And every day God came to this garden to have this relationship with them. This peace, this shalom was given by God to earth and exists in paradise in the harmony between creator and the creation. And we know that people destroyed it. They destroyed just one piece. And you know, it's like whole wall with no gaps. But you can take one brick and it start falling apart. They destroyed just one thing in their relationship with God. And whole world, whole peace, whole shalom was ruined in a moment. And God always dreamed about this peace. God always dreamed about this shalom between him and his creation people. And as I said, it was one of the central ideas of Jesus Christ to bring this peace to people. And please open with me Book of John, Gospel of John, chapter 14, verse 27. It's the last night. In a few hours, Jesus will be betrayed, beaten, crucified, and will be killed. There will be a lot of sorrows in his life in just a few hours. This is what he said. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do, but I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. I brought and I give you my peace. Not like this world, it's completely different peace. I give you my peace. I leave my peace with you. It always was dream of God to give us this peace. And Paul said in Romans chapter 5, verse 1, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus did what he came for. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 14, 15, and 16. For he, Jesus, himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinance, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so make peace and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. Jesus came and brought this peace to us between people, and he made this peace between people and God. And when we talk about this peace, as they said, it's not just no war, no conflicts. Jesus came to make me whole, to make me complete, to restore what was broken. Jesus came to take my life, which sometimes is broken, it's broken relationship, broken families, broken, I don't know, mindset or something else. He came to take these pieces and restore them and make you whole. He came to bring you shalom. He came to bring you peace. But in order to bring this peace, you need to do something. It's not like just, ta-da, I came, peace to you, like, be in peace, like. And because he said peace, it automatically became peace. No. In order to bring peace, this peace, Jesus did something. First of all, he took responsibility for the situation. And here again, I wanted to remind you this idea of responsibility I found in this verse, Isaiah 9:6. Because he's wonderful, he's the wisest person in the universe, he's Almighty God, he's Father of eternity, and he's creator of this peace, he's owner or like prince of this peace. He took responsibility for the situation. What does it mean? There's death, or there is disease or sickness in my life. Jesus said, I am responsible for this. All my sins I did in my life, all my sins I will make in my life in future, Jesus said, I am responsible for these sins. Like maybe you was fired, maybe like your heart was broken because of some guy or girl, I didn't know, or something else. Jesus said, I take responsibility for this situation. More of this, you know, to bring peace, you need to pay. Jesus said, he not just said, I'm responsible. He said, because I'm responsible, I will pay for this. And he died on the cross. And this is his payment. Like, so it's not just say, okay, I'm responsible. But peace, as anything in this universe, peace costs something. And peace for all my life, peace for the whole world, cost a lot. And Jesus paid all costs to eliminate this situation. To bring this peace, to make my heart during this problem not be troubled, he paid with his life, he paid with his blood. And he was like the only who was able to do this. I want to read Colossians chapter 1, verse 19 to 22. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. And you who once were aligned and hostile in mind, going evil deeds, he was now reconciled in his blood, body of flesh, by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him. To make you whole again, to make you shalom again, he paid with his blood. Because he said, I want to see you blameless. I want to see you holy. I want to be with you. I will pay. So I want to stuck with this idea for a moment, guys. Because we need to understand. If I want to build a peace with somebody, to be in harmony with somebody, my wife, my children, my friends, my people in the ministry, I don't know, people around me at work, I need to understand that peace costs something. And if nobody is ready to pay for this peace, there will be no peace at all. Because peace always costs something. And guess who is responsible to bring this peace? Who understands? Who is like mature enough, spiritually mature enough, to say, I will pay for this. So talking about us and Jesus, it was my fault, my sins, it's my fault. The disease or sickness or death, it's fall of this world. We just destroy this world. It's not Jesus' fault. It wasn't his responsibility to say, I will pay for this. And the only Jesus who is not guilt in all these problems is Jesus. And you know, this is the only way was for us to restore the situation. Only Jesus was able to say, I'll take responsibility, because only he saw the problem. We live in our life, this world live their lives, and they don't see the problems. Jesus, from the above of his heaven, like his mind and his holiness, he see the problems. Only he understand the problem. He said, I'll take responsibility for these problems. More of this, I will pay for them. And this was the only way to build or to bring peace to us. And this is what Jesus did. And now this task fell on the shoulders of the disciples of Jesus Christ. If you want already like to experience this peace, you need to act like Jesus Christ. Because Jesus used to have peace only because he acted in the right way. He humbled himself, he took responsibility, and he paid, and he brought the peace. And when I am in the problem with somebody, when I am in the problem with myself, with my mindset or something else, when I'm in problem in the work, the only way to build peace, the only way to bring peace in my life is to act like Jesus Christ. I want to read with you Ephesians chapter 4, verse 3. Paul said, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. It's verse 3, but very important what is in verse 1 and 2. I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Humility, gentleness, patience, and love. This is the way Jesus brought peace into my life. This is the only way you can bring peace in your life and in the lives of people around you. To act like Jesus, to be like Jesus. You know, to be the people of peace means to participate in each other's life, to help each other to restore this peace, to help to build each other, shalom each other. If you have some trouble or problems, I need to be involved to bring, if I want to bring the peace into your life. This is how Jesus did. It was his way to act, to bring the peace. And if I want to have this peace right now, you know, the life of Jesus was a demonstration of this peace that always awaits us on heaven. Every disease was healed. Every demon was cast out. Every hunger person was saturated. There was complete 100% peace around Jesus. There is no disease, there is no sickness, there is no problem, there is no death. And when John the Baptist sent his disciples to Jesus Christ and said, tell us, you're the one who's supposed to come, or we need to wait somebody else? And Jesus said, go to John and say what you see. dead raised from death. Every sorrow was cast out. Hungry people, they're no anymore hungry. Everybody who has have disease now have health. This is perfect peace Jesus brought, and his life was demonstration of this perfect peace what awaits us on heaven. But it's about future. What about now? When I'm surrounded with the problems, I am surrounded by sorrows. How I can have peace in this world? But I have peace in my life, not because there is no sorrow or death. Now I can have peace because I know that Jesus holds everything in my life in his hands. He who is wonderful counselor, he who is Prince of Peace, he who is Almighty God, he who is everlasting Father, and he who reigns forever holds my life in his hands. This is why I have peace. I know everything is under control. Everything in my life is under control. Even when I go astray, I know God is powerful enough, he is Almighty God, to bring me back and to restore this. Even when I go in problems I cannot control this disease or sickness, I cannot control this death in my family, but I know God is, everything is God, is under God's control. This is why I have peace. And I know this peace with no death, with no diseases, with no any problems awaits me on heaven. And when we talk about Jesus who reigns forever, it's not just like from today, like or from tomorrow, like in 5 years and then forever. Forever means yesterday. He reigns when yesterday I made the mistakes in my life. And he took these mistakes and converted them into peace. Today, he reigns and I have peace because I know everything is under God's control. I'm not worried about tomorrow because I know Jesus reigns forever. And tomorrow, when I face this tomorrow, when I will face this next year, I am calm and I have peace in my life. Why? Because I know my life and everything is in God's control. He who is almighty, who is the most wise person, he knows how to restore my life. He knows how to bring peace to my life. And you know, so this idea of peace is not just the absence of conflicts. The real peace need to be means to take what is broken and fully restore it. The situation, the life, the whole world. This is what Jesus did for me. And this is what Jesus expects from me. Today, not tomorrow, not in heaven, but today, I am able to experience this peace. Not because there is no problems around, but because my peace determines by the knowledge and faith that everything is under control of wise and almighty Prince of Peace. This is what I learned in the past year. Today is, by the way, the last Sunday in this year. Do you know this? Yeah. And today is New Year party. And I didn't know what to expect from the next year. There's a few offerings for me, like business offering, like in ministry there's offering. And, you know, you try to decide what to do, like what is the right choice. How to build this relationship with people who have teenagers. Like my children, they are already teenagers, like freaking out of their minds. Like, oh! Sometimes they make you crazy. Like, what to do with them? You're able to experience peace daily because you know and you believe in Jesus Christ, and you know he's the most wise. He's almighty. He's the king. He's author of this peace. And to bring this peace in my life, he died. He paid the highest price so I can have this peace. And as I said, this is what Jesus did for me. And that's what Jesus expects from me as his disciple. And we pretty much weekly say with this, with Spring of Life Church, we exist for the glory of God, and we glorify God by making disciples. And we make disciples through the word, worship, and fellowship. Yeah, there is no way to make disciples if you are not ready to bring peace to these people. But to bring peace to these people, you need to take this act of responsibility to be involved in their problems, to participate in their sorrows, to participate in their problems, to pay for them. This is the only way to bring peace. This is the only way to make them disciples of Jesus Christ. So this peace starts in your heart. It continues in church family, in our ministries, departments. There's worship who want to praise today, tonight, who hold the mic, like who the main guy, like who will do this, like this is my role. I don't know. There's a lot of relationship. That's why we have live groups. That's why we invite people to participate in a live group. This is the place where you can build this shalom, where you can build this peace, build the relationship, participate in the life of each other, to experience your problems, your sorrows, to support each other in these problems, pay with your time, money, I don't know, emotions, something else to pay. Because this is the only way to bring peace in life of each other. And this is the only way to attract people around us who thirsty for this peace, who was created for this peace. And tonight, the last Sunday of this year, I want to call you to become a people of peace, to be people of peace. Peace, not like just peace, but real spiritual peace, shalom, Jesus brought into our lives by his blood and death. And spread this peace around us. This is the only way to glorify God, by making disciples. Amen. Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for Jesus Christ. Thank you that you are Almighty God and the most wise and the most powerful, and you author of the peace, and you had this desire to bring this peace to us, and you did it through Jesus Christ, through his death and the resurrection. God, thank you so much that today we have and we can have this peace. Not because there is no problems, no sorrows, losses in our lives, but because we know everything is under your control. Everything, all our lives is in your loving hands. And we know what expect in future, an eternal life with you. God, please help us to have this peace, to be whole, to be restored daily in our lives with you and through you. Help us to spread this peace around us with your help, with our brothers and sisters in our church and outside of the church. Help us to bring this peace to people around us, to help them to have this peace. Help us to make this decision to pay for peace in others' lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
sing, no other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name, Jesus.
So will I. The sum of
Had this hope of reconciliation between man and you. And when we rejected you, and when we chose against you, and when we didn't submit to your will, Lord, you sent your Son in order to die for us and to reconcile us to you. I pray that we know that, I pray that we see that, and I pray that we worship you for that, and that's in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor Paul. Thank you, Worship Band, for this amazing service. And thank you guys for being part of this service. Couple of announcements. And before we pray, first of all, after we pray, we're going to have fellowship. So stick around for that. Give us an opportunity to say hi to you. Here in Spirit of Life Church, we grow and spiritually mature through life groups. And if you're not part of the life group, we encourage you guys to be part of that. A bunch of opportunities to serve others and serve your church. So if you want to do that, just the show initiative, talk to me or any of our leaders. January 24th through 27th, we're going to have a teens camp. So if you know someone who wants to be part of that, just talk to any of the teens ministry leaders. You guys know that today is the 30th and tomorrow is the 31st. Do you guys have any plans for New Year's? Yeah. So if your plan was to show up here at church and go to the center, nothing's going to be there. This year we're celebrating and New Year's with our live groups. If you don't have any plans and you didn't talk to your live group leader, I encourage you guys to do that. If you don't have any plans and that was your plan to show up here, just talk to us. We'll direct you in the right direction and we'll show you a live group that will be more than happy to celebrate a New Year's with you. I want to finish with this thought. You know, at Christmas we give gifts, and it's amazing to receive gifts. And for the 2019, that's my resolution, is to give gifts to people. The talents that God gave me, give them back to people. And that starts with just being nicer to your neighbor, just maybe caring a little bit more about what's going on and serving your community. You know, our God he's a mighty God, and he's a wonderful counsel, and he will reign forever. And I want you guys to always remember that. Let's all stand up and pray. God, thank you so much for this opportunity, and thank you so much for the service. We want to remember who you are and what you've done for us, and we want to serve you and praise you with everything that we got. In your name I pray. Amen.